Spiral by Jeff Hearn. A monstrous mesh of earth and wind fused the dark, turbulent sea of clouds to a swirling, dark, fluid landscape. Zigzagging, spiraling with supernatural rage, it crossed the plains, picking up, eating everything in its path, and tossing the bones to the surrounding darkness. Writhing like a desert snake swimming through moonlit sand, it moved randomly, swiftly, toward the lonely stretch of highway. Millicent Rayford held tightly to the steering wheel, her pressing fists greased with raindrops and blood, her auburn hair soaked, clinging to the sides of her face. She kept looking up through those gaping mascara-smeared circles, looking at the black pool of night splashing in the rearview mirror, looking for the headlights that had been chasing her. Her car lurched, the relentless winds slamming into its sides. The wipers fought to keep even some minimal amount of visibility occurring for the distraught driver. One powerful slap and jerk of wind ripped away the left wiper blade. She felt a sudden rush to scream, but held it back. Millicent caught sight of the tornado, just as the highway rolled out its asphalt tongue on a winding downward slope. She glimpsed the tornado coming up on her left side, shaping itself out of the mad darkness, a gushing massive wall of wind leaping into her peripheral vision. A split second later, Millicent's head hammered against the ceiling. Her hands let go of the steering wheel, and the world turned upside down. As one hand grabbed and twisted the rearview mirror, the other slapped its palm against the windshield. The tornado was on top of her now, and the world turned over, over and over, jarring, spinning, dropping forever, crashing, spraying rain and glass. Lights were bursting in her head. The roaring beast expunged the scream she could no longer hold back. As she was helplessly tossed about inside the crashing vehicle, one thought chased her into the darkness. I'm dead. Millicent awoke from her dream. The dampness was still so fresh, so real. The nightmare was still such a vivid picture stamped against her inner eyelids. She weakly opened her left eye to the darkness. She couldn't find her pillow. She mustered up strength to push away from the bed, to try and clear the blur floating in her left eye. Her cheeks and chin felt wet from tears. Another tear raced down to the corner of her mouth. Her tongue caught it as it slithered in between her lips. She didn't recognize the taste of blood, still flowing out of her nightmare, cold pelting rain, splashing down, soaking through her hair and clothes, washed away the tears and re-smeared the muddy makeup on her misshapen face, and also removed some foreign substance, keeping her right eye glued shut. It fluttered to open finally, to take in the view of darkness. Still, she couldn't focus on anything. Her bruised, broken fingers pushed down painfully into the weedy muck of her bed, and a sharper pain shot through her entire body. She was fully awake now. I'm alive. Her thought screamed, her lips quivering, unable to say those words. Millicent sat up on her knees, her eyes searching the cold darkness forming shapes around her. She spotted the crushed remains of the station wagon nearby, twisted on its side, behind a veil of steam hissing at her. The driver's door hung open on one hinge. Millicent frowned, a disturbed child lost in darkness, lost in a mystery. A primal instinct of panic surged through her now. She couldn't figure out where she was or why she was there. She wasn't even sure of who she was. Only flashes of faint, brief images flickered at the end of a dark tunnel, images from the depths of her mind trying to surface. The blade sliced through the air and came down, sinking into the flesh between the shoulder blades. It pulled back out with a twisting jerk, then rose into the air, held higher up and further back, preparing to strike again with a harder blow. The light switch flicked on, 40 watts illuminating the blood-splattered walls and carnage on the tiled floor, and Millicent Rayford screamed. Her eyes opened. The pounding in her ears eventually subsided, carried away by the distant roar of the monster wind. The seesawing earth eventually steadied. Millicent saw herself rising, standing to her feet, the invisible fists of balance tightening their grips on her aching ankles. But it was someone else making this happen, wasn't it? She was outside of herself, watching, wondering, as her thin body stood and moved forward. She sensed a need to flee from the darkness of the road, from something that would be coming along its path, coming after her. Out of the swirling gray mist emerged a ghostly, fantastic structure. It seemed to be shaking the earth, this opulent building bounding across the mire toward her. Struggling to push back the dried blood caked on her eyelids, Millicent looked up at the looming Victorian edifice and gasped. The ground shook and tilted again, and Millicent collapsed at the foot of the front porch steps. Just before passing out, she saw an expanding light reach down to her, a figure approaching, a man in a flannel shirt. Then she felt a rush of warmth wrap itself around her. She was caught up in the wind, twirling through space, being pulled up to the heavens. The man's voice whispered in her ear,
It's going to be all right.
I've got you. Charles Wentworth, Millicent's lover, screamed. He entered the room tremulously, his horrified eyes drawn down instantly to the sight of the mutilated body. No. Millicent awoke. She sat up on the burnt orange couch and caused a warm rag to fall from her aching forehead. There, a soft yet raspy, mothering voice responded.
Rest, my dear.
Millicent moaned and closed her eyes again. Too weak to hold her position, she slowly sank back down to the couch, where her head met the indented pillow. My head is spinning terribly.
You'll be fine.
An ambulance is on its way, as I recall.
Oh, what a night this was.
Millicent looked up at the textured ceiling. I'm not dead?
I don't think so.
Millicent weakly turned her head to survey the room quickly, a dark and cozy den room, and find the source of the soft, aged voice. She found a small woman's figure seated in a rocking chair, hair pulled up in an angel white bun, next to an ingle nook, where a small stack of kindling crackled in the warmth of a loving fire. Millicent frowned, yet faintly smiled at her surroundings. Where am I? The old woman in the rocking chair stopped her knitting and leaned forward. She answered,
My poor Allison. This has been a terrible ordeal for you.
Try and rest. Allison, do I know you? Tremors were still rumbling in the back of her mind. You seem familiar. Where's the man, the one who found me? The old woman nodded.
Of course, my child.
The thin, pale lips on the small, wrinkly face turned up a dry, chapped smile. I feel so dizzy.
Like a spinning top, Allison.
Trying to keep its balance, spinning on the rail of a spiral staircase. Who's Allison? Millicent blinked.
Do you remember writing that?
The old woman went on.
On the rail of a spiral staircase. Always writing and creating, my Allison.
Such a way with words. Are you speaking to someone else here? Millicent forced herself to sit up. Her feet found the floor, and she briefly balanced herself, palms pressed down hard against the seat cushion, her arms twisting back and forth on wobbly joints as her fingers tried to grab hold. Everything was so unreal for her now, except the pain. She tried to block it out, her mind busily working to build a mental dam against it. Everything was so muddled, and yet she could start to feel her memories being restructured, her mind throbbing, working extremely hard to bring her life back to her. Wait. Her body trembled. She remembered that there was some sort of danger she was in. Yes, something was after her. Thing. The nightmare pounced on her suddenly. The wild-eyed creature attacked, savagely swinging the large knife through the air. Millicent kept backing away from the snarling beast as it advanced upon her with a frenzied viciousness. Another swing of the gleaming blade, and this time the downward angled arc left a wake of spewing blood. When she came to again, a sweet fragrance was drifting over her. Millicent was grateful to have some pleasant, soothing ointment administered to at least one of her aching senses. A lily-scented candle flickered on a nearby table. Lilies. It was the old woman's voice again.
Seems it's always been everyone's favorite.
Her words seemed to turn away from Millicent as she added,
Iris, did you light the candle?
Millicent's face twitched and stirred into a frown. Who?
Iris. My favorite little girl.
The old woman said,
Come over here, sweetheart.
Favorite? From behind Millicent, a child's soft voice surfaced in a whisper. It wasn't me, Grandma. Millicent tried to lift and turn her head to see the girl, but the walls were pounding, her vision seesawed. She had to give up and return her tarnished crown to the pillowcase. Iris, she absently considered, that's a pretty name. She heard a light giggle, then the sound of tapping heels. They danced across the floor, and a door closed. Then, gone, the little brown-haired girl wasn't there. Brown-haired? Why, yes, but she was. She somehow was. This little girl, Iris. Brown-haired Iris. Maybe that was just a bloodstain in Millicent's imagination. The colors on the palette darkened by the beatings of the mind, and the flickering lights getting dimmer. Not brown hair, but auburn? Where'd she go? Millicent asked the darkness.
Running off to play.
The old woman chuckled. She disappeared. Just disappeared. The old woman added,
Are you fully awake, dear?
A sharp pain shot through Millicent's head. She fell into unconsciousness. Mrs. Wentworth's scream was unearthly. The wild-eyed woman attacked, savagely swinging the butcher's knife through the air. This contorted, horrific creature, violently psychotic, out of control, possessed by some supernatural entity, would be unstoppable. Her eyes were glowing, burning with the lust for shredding and the shedding of blood. Millicent kept backing away, terrified by this thing unleashed upon her, attacking in an electrified energy, and that enormous cutting tool, reflected, gleaming in the tears, swinging in closer to swipe them away. Her scream trailed off to an unintelligible, primal wail. When Millicent awoke, the wail continued, but distant, muffled by walls, outside of her, somewhere within the walls of this house. She pulled herself up on her elbows, aching, and discovered her disjointed self lying in the quake of a twisted, flowery bed cover. The couch was now a queen-sized bed, in a dark room with only light coming through an opened doorway. A doorway in which a tall, angular silhouette was framed. The wailing was real, but further away now. A mother's panic was taking over, and Millicent gasped, "A baby!" The baby's cry faded away, then a sigh of cool air from a vent somewhere just above her interrupted the heavy silence.
There's no baby. You imagine that.
Millicent sensed this bushy-haired figure at the door was coldly analyzing her, a cruelness in the tone of her voice. Millicent asked, "Who are you?"
"Alice.
My name is Alice. Came the answer from the tall, dark figure, and an icy chill ran through Millicent's blood. Millicent moved to the edge of the bed, eyes following her feet, and pushing along, her legs slowly lowered over the side, and her feet dropped into darkness to touch the carpet. She felt a warm wave of energy and courage move through her and decided she'd try to stand. "Where am I?"
You've had a seizure.
Alice informed her. "A seizure?" And then she remembered. Mother had seizures. Alice spoke very carefully with her choice of words.
I was coming to check on you.
Seizures can be deadly, you know. Feebly on her feet, Millicent swayed, reaching for but finding no support, and moved toward the woman whose features remained hidden in shadows. Alice turned quickly, with a powerful sweep of her shoulders, and only the copper color of her thick, flowing hair reflected a wave of light. "Alice," Millicent called after her, "help me." Then she caught hold of the bedpost by her side and steadied her balance to calm her breathing. "Alice, come back." The baby's wail returned, greeting Millicent in the hallway. There, she tracked and saw the door at the end, where the sound emanated from the light beyond it, from this glowing threshold at the end of the hall. Millicent started for the door. The door opened. The baby's cry stopped as if it never was. A small girl, maybe 5 years old, with long blonde hair in ponytails and wearing a pretty pink dress, stepped out. She smiled at Millicent, a lovely smile, a lovely face. "There is a baby," Millicent said.
Where?
The small girl asked. "In there." Millicent frowned. "In there, where you were."
My name's Mandy,
the girl announced.
Who are you?
"Don't you know me?" Millicent was tired.
Yes, Allison.
Mandy replied, sounding suddenly rather old for her age.
There's no baby. No baby exists except in your dreams, except in your nightmares.
"What?" Millicent was feeling weaker.
As do I.
The girl stepped closer, her face getting longer.
But we can't run anymore, can we?
"Run?" Mandy reached up and joined her hands to Millicent's, then started skipping around her. Millicent staggered weakly, turning in place, her arms being pulled, hurting, the girl's hold tightening on her hands.
Round and round and round we run,
the girl sang.
What goes around comes around, goes around, comes around.
Like a spinning top.
Round and round and round we run.
"Stop," Millicent begged. The hallway, the walls, the railing, the ceiling, the carpet, all becoming a blur now, spinning past her, faster and faster, rushing waves of wind. "Stop!" Millicent closed her eyes.
Round and round and round we run.
Alice's voice joined in. Don't let her get me! Mandy cried out. Shrieks of terror and shrieks of laughter spilled through the rushing winds. Mommy!
Mommy fell and hurt her head.
Mommy's dead.
Smothered in bed.
Mommy fell and hurt her head. And laughter ascended, spiraling upward.
Round and round and round we run.
Iris's voice sang out.
Who is this with us today?
Grandma's voice, far away, echoed. Make this stop, Millicent pleaded. The laughing, crying voices answered.
But I can't.
The first stab plunged deep into her lower abdomen. The second one, with greater force, drove up under her rib cage. More followed, ripping her apart. The creature with the copper-colored bush of hair, flowing with the scream of her charge. This creature had gone right through Millicent and had taken down Mrs. Wentworth with such tremendous force.
He's mine!
and Millicent could not stop her, not strong enough. She was only a ghost, after all, a made-up name. She wasn't even real. And she couldn't stop this creature. She could never stop her. Just as Iris couldn't, or baby Mandy, or Grandma, her mother, Mrs. Wentworth, or all the others. Iris ran down the flight of stairs. Grandma! The old woman was asleep in her chair, asleep to Iris, who paid no attention to the spilled medicine around her feet. Grandma! Iris cried hard. The baby's not moving! Mommy won't wake up! Crouching in the shadows by the ingle nook, flames in her eyes, Alice snickered. Heavy feet pounded down the stairs, shaking the whole house. Iris turned and saw the man in the flannel shirt rushing for the front door, a horrified wail bursting from his lungs. Held in his arms, a small form wrapped in a pink quilt. He opened the front door and ran out into the night of flashing red lights and siren sounds. Daddy! The light switch flicked on. Crouching over the lifeless body, the knife held high and dripping blood, Alice froze. She blinked, her auburn hair wet with blood and sweat, thick strands hanging over her eyes. Tears welled in those eyes, and when she blinked them out and let them wash over her blood-spattered cheeks, she was Millicent. Millicent had finally caught up to her. Millicent had taken the knife from her, and Millicent released the blood-greased handle, and the knife clattered across the dark puddles on the tiled floor. Her voice was faint. I couldn't stop her. She's too strong. Charles clasped his head with both hands and screamed. She killed my mother, my sisters, my grandmother, eventually my father. She made him kill himself, friends of mine, ones she didn't like. I couldn't stop her. Charles fell to his knees, covered his face with his hands, and wept. She wants to kill me, too. She wants you all to herself, Charles. Millicent stood and looked at her lover, down on his knees and retching. I won't let her, I won't. Millicent turned quickly, found the knob, and flung open the back door. Racing out into the night, she cried, I won't! She blinked, awakened once more. The clouds were spiraling above her broken body. Charles stepped into view, into the focus of her one good eye. His own eyes blood red, she saw, glazed with a hellish rage. Charles, please, Millicent whimpered, wanting to reach up to him, to hold him. Charles was not Charles anymore, but rather a demon whose face was contorted with anger and agony. And as he bent down over her, she saw the fire burning beneath his skin. She smelled the exhausted sulfur and liquor on his steaming breaths. He reached down with a white-knuckled claw. She saw the fingers, wet and quivering, and felt them grabbing and ripping her throat. But no, instead, he pulled back his hand, now tightly clutching a large, jagged rock that oozed with mud. The tornado was moving in. She could see the monstrous shape whipping back and forth, almost right on top of them. Charles raised the rock in his muddied fist, trying to steady himself to send the crushing blow to Millicent's head. You killed her, he screamed. You killed my wife. Millicent's eyes clouded in the final seconds, but she saw the giant shape of their killer emerge. Tall, spidery, the splitting death mask rolling maniacal eyes, the flames of auburn hair flowing, the mad face of Alice emerging from the blackness, laughing, then descending upon them. Afterwards, his bloodied fingers still clutching the jagged rock, Charles stood and turned to face the slashing winds.
Who is this with us today?
Millie, Iris, the old woman asked, still knitting.
Is this your friend, Alice?
Alice?
Alice. 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 Alice.